when he was cut off from the land of the living and smitten for the sin of his people. A grave was assigned him among the wicked, and a burial place with evildoers. Though he had done no wrong, nor any falsehood. But the Lord was pleased to crush him in infirmity. If he gives his life as an offering for sin, he shall see his descendants in a long life, and the will of the Lord shall be accomplished through him. Because of his affliction, he shall see the light in fullness of days. Reading from the letter to the Hebrews. Brothers and sisters, since we have a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus, the Son of God, let us hold fast to our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who has similarly been tested in every way, yet without sin. So let us confidently approach the throne of grace to receive mercy and to find grace for timely help. In the days when Christ was in the flesh, he He offered prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to the one who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and when he was made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Judas, his betrayer, also knew the place, because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas got a band of soldiers and guards from the chief priests and the Pharisees and went there with lanterns, torches, and weapons. Jesus, knowing everything that was going to happen to him, went out and said to them, "Whom are you looking for?" They answered him, "Jesus the Nazarene." He said to them, "I am." Judas, his betrayer, was also with them. When he said to them, "I am," they turned away and fell to the ground. So he again asked them, "Whom are you looking for?" They said, "Jesus the Nazarene." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am. So if you are looking for me, let these men go." This was to fulfill what he had said, "I have not lost any of those who gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword into its scabbard. Shall I not drink the cup that the Father gave me?"
So the band of soldiers, the tribune, and the Jewish guards seized Jesus, bound him, and brought him to Annas first. He was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, who was the first priest that year. It was Caiaphas who was counsel the Jews, that it was better that one man should die rather than the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed him. Now the other disciple was known to the high priest, and he entered the courtyard of the high priest with Jesus. But Peter stood at the gate outside. So the other disciple, the acquaintance of the high priest, went out and spoke to the gatekeeper and brought Peter in. Then the maid who was the gatekeeper said to Peter, "You are not one of this man's disciples, are you?" He said, I am not. Now the slaves and the guards were standing around a charcoal fire that they made because it was cold and were warming themselves. Peter was also standing there keeping warm. The high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his doctrine. Jesus answered him, I have spoken publicly to the world. I have always taught in a synagogue or in a temple area where all the Jews gather, and in secret I have said nothing. Why ask me? Ask those who heard me when I said to them. They know what I said. When he had said this, one of the temple guards standing there struck Jesus and said, Is this the way you answer the high priest? Jesus answered him, If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me? Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing there keeping warm, and they said to him, You are not one of his disciples, are you? He denied it and said, I am not. One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the one whose ear Peter had cut off, said, Didn't I see you in the garden with him? Again, Peter denied it. And immediately the cock crowed.
Then they brought Jesus from Caiaphas to the praetorium. It was morning. And they themselves did not enter the praetorium in order not to be defiled, so they could eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and said, What charge do you bring against this man? They answered and said to him, If he were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you. At this, Pilate said to them, Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law. The Jews answered him, We do not have the right to execute anyone, in order that the word of Jesus might be fulfilled, that he said, indicating the kind of death he would die. So Pilate went back into the praetorium and summoned Jesus and said to him, Are you the king of the Jews? Jesus answered, Do you say this on your own, or have others told you about me?" Pilate answered, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom does not belong to this world. If my kingdom did belong to this world, my attendants would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not here." So Pilate said to him, "Then you are a king." Jesus answered, "You say I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate said to him, "What is truth?" When he had said this, he again went out to the Jews and said to them, "I find no guilt in him, but you have a custom that I release one prisoner to you at Passover. Do you want me to release to you the king of the Jews?" They cried out again, "Not this one, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a revolutionary. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him scourged. And the soldiers wove a crown out of thorns, placed it on his head, and clothed him in a purple cloak. And they came to him and said, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they struck him repeatedly. Once more, Pilate went out and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you, so that you may know that I find no guilt in him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple cloak. And he said to them, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and the guards saw him, they cried out, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no guilt in him." The Jews answered, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die, because he made himself the Son of God." Now, when Pilate heard this statement, he became even more afraid, and went back into the praetorium and said to Jesus, "Where are you from?" Jesus did not answer him. So Pilate said to Jesus, "Do you not speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and I have power to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it had not been given to you from above. For this reason, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin." Consequently, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release him, you are not a friend of Caesar. Everyone who makes himself a king opposes Caesar." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus out and seated him on the judge's bench in the place called Stone Pavement, in Hebrew, Gabbatha. It was preparation day for Passover, and it was about noon. And he said to the Jews, "Behold your king." They cried out, take him away, crucify him." Pilate said to them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but Caesar." Then he handed him over to them to be crucified.
So they took Jesus, and carrying the cross himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull. In Hebrew, Golgotha. There they were crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus in the middle. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." Now many of the Jews read this inscription. Because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek, so the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews." But that he said, "I am the King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four shares, a share for each soldier. They also took his tunic, but the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top down. So they said to one another, "Let's not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who it will be, in order that the passage of Scripture might be fulfilled that says, 'They divided my garments among them, and for my vesture they cast lots.'" This is what the soldiers did. Standing by the cross of Jesus was his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary of Magdala. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple there whom he loved, he said to his mother, "Woman, behold your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Behold your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his home. After this, aware that everything was now finished, in order that the scripture might be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I thirst." There was a vessel filled with common wine. So they put a sponge soaked in wine on a sprig of hyssop and put it up to his mouth. When Jesus had taken the wine, he said, "It is finished." And bowing his head, he handed over the spirit.
since it was preparation day, in order that the bodies might not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, for the Sabbath day of that week was a solemn one. The Jews asked Pilate that their legs be broken, and that they may be taken down. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first, then of the other, one who was crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. But one soldier thrust his lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. An eyewitness has testified, and his testimony is true. He knows that he is speaking the truth, so that you also may come to believe. For this happened so that the scripture passage might be fulfilled. Not a bone of it will be broken. And again, another passage says, they will look upon him whom they have pierced. After this, Joseph of Arimathea, secretly a disciple of Jesus for fear of the Jews, asked Pilate if he could remove the body of Jesus, and Pilate permitted it. So he came and took his body. Nicodemus, the one who had first come to him at night, also came bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and bound it with burial cloths along with the spices, according to the Jewish burial custom. Now in the place where he had been crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden a new tomb in which no one had yet been buried. So they laid Jesus there because of the Jewish preparation day, for the tomb was close by. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
On the Feast of the Immaculate Conception, December 8th, in the year 2015, one of my very best friends passed from a very rare form of cancer. So rare at that time, and I think to this day, there is no tried and true protocol for treatment. So he endured a couple of major experimental surgeries. In addition to all of that and treatments, he endured hip replacements and suffered through pancreatitis. So many of us who were his good friends kept asking God, why him? Of all people, why him? If there's anyone who didn't deserve this lot in life, it really was him. He was generous to a fault. He was a good husband, father and son and brother and faithful friend to many. He was a man of deep faith and prayer, and he wasn't afraid to share that with many. He loved the church. He was a trustee in the largest parish in our Diocese of Buffalo and very, very actively involved in that parish, St. Vincent de Paul Society. And through all that he endured, he never really complained. I don't know how he did it, because I couldn't do the same. I know that. Did he question God? Why me? I know he did. However, he always lived to beat his odds, always knowing what his odds were. And the one thing that I can say for him, he was never, ever defined by his sickness. His greatest gift to me was showing me real faith in the face of adversity. adversity. He did want to live, but if it wasn't meant to be, he trusted the example of Jesus, who shows us what obedience is all about. Father, your will, not mine. Lay down life. And so I look to him, who tells the story that Jesus told us first of all, that God really does have us, that the victory has already been won by Jesus over human death and misery and darkness, which grants us that great gateway to eternal living, free from every hindrance, every darkness, every suffering, every struggle, every pain, even free from evil and sin. Scripture scholars suggest to us that the passion reading we heard, the one today from John's Gospel, really isn't a passion reading at all, as compared to the passion readings in the other Gospels, Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And so think about it. It is true. There is no graphic relaying in the story we heard today of Jesus' suffering, or graphic description even of his crucifixion and death. He lays down his own life on his terms. It is not taken from him. Jesus decides when the time is right and goes to the appointed place on his own. God has the upper hand, not the authorities. And Jesus explains the significance of all of these events to Pilate, not the other way around. What we celebrate today is what Jesus did. It's a bold proclamation of life, death, and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the glorification that's given by his Father in heaven. It's a celebration of victory. There is no defeat here. Christ, our life, by his cross and death, destroyed the power of death and evil absolutely forever. May we face every death in our own lives, every single cross, determined to die with Jesus and to rise with him in glory. Blood and water poured from the side of Jesus, and the earth gave forth from itself the church, each and every one of us. Only by the wood of the cross go I, go you, go us together.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for the Holy Church of God, that our God and Lord be pleased to give her peace, to guard her, and to unite her throughout the whole world, and grant that, leading our life in tranquility and quiet, we may glorify God the Father Almighty. Almighty.
Almighty, ever-living God, who in Christ revealed your glory to all the nations, watch over the works of your mercy, that your church, spread throughout all the world, may persevere with steadfast faith in confessing your name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for our most holy Father, Pope Francis, that our God and Lord, who chose him for the order of bishops, may keep him safe and unharmed for the Lord's holy church to govern the holy people of God.
Almighty, ever-living God, by whose decree all things were founded, look with favor on our prayers, and in your kindness protect the Pope chosen for us, that under him the Christian people, governed by you their Maker, may grow in merit by reason of their faith, through Christ our Lord. Ever-living God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is sanctified and governed, hear our humble prayer for your ministers, that by the gift of your grace all may serve you faithfully, through Christ our Lord.
That our God and Lord may open wide the ears of their inmost hearts and unlock the gates of his mercy, that, having received forgiveness for all their sins through the water of rebirth, they too may be one with Christ Jesus our Lord.
Almighty, ever-living God, who make your church ever fruitful with new offspring, increase the faith and understanding of catechumens, that reborn in the font of baptism, they may be added to the number of your adopted children, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Sisters who believe in Christ, that our God and Lord may be pleased as they live the truth to gather them together and keep them in his one church.
Almighty, ever-living God, who gather what is scattered and keep together what you have gathered, look kindly on the flock of your Son, that those whom one baptism has consecrated may be joined together in integrity of faith and united in the bond of charity, through Christ our Lord.
spoke first, that he may grant them to advance in love of his name and in faithfulness to his covenant.
Almighty, ever-living God, who bestowed your promises on Abraham and his descendants, graciously hear the prayers of your church, that the people you first made your own may attain the fullness of redemption through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not believe in Christ, that, enlightened by the Holy Spirit, they too may enter on the way of salvation.
Almighty, ever-living God, grant to those who do not confess Christ that by walking before you with a sincere heart, they may find the truth, and that we ourselves, being constant in mutual love and striving to understand more fully the mystery of your life, may be made more perfect witnesses to your love in the world. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those who do not acknowledge God, that following what is right in sincerity of heart, they may find the way to God Himself.
Almighty, ever-living God, who created all people to seek you always by desiring you and by finding you come to rest, grant, we pray, that despite every harmful obstacle, all may recognize the signs of your fatherly love and the witness of the good works done by those who believe in you. And so, in gladness confess you, the one true God and Father of our human race, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray also for those in public office, that our God and Lord may direct their minds and hearts according to His will, for the true peace and freedom of all.
Almighty, ever-living God, in whose hand lies every human heart and the rights of peoples, look with favor, we pray, on those who govern with authority over us, that throughout the whole world, the prosperity of peoples, the assurance of peace, and freedom of religion may, through your gift, be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.
To God the Father Almighty, that He may cleanse the world of all errors, banish disease, drive out hunger, unlock prisons, loosen fetters, granting to travelers safety, to pilgrims return, help to the the sick, and salvation to the dying.
Almighty ever-living God, comfort of mourners, strength of all who toil, may prayers of those who cry out in any tribulation come before you, that all may rejoice, because in their hour of need your mercy was at hand, through Christ our Lord.
Victims of abuse, that our God and Lord be pleased to give them peace, that our Catholic communities may offer them love and support, and that their faith may be sustained.
Almighty ever-living God, you sent your Son to walk among us and to heal all those who suffered in body and spirit. Watch over those who have been victims of abuse. Restore their trust, console them with your grace, and embrace them with your love. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray, dearly beloved, for a swift end to the coronavirus pandemic that afflicts our world, that our God and Father will heal the sick, strengthen those who care for them, and help us all to persevere in faith.
Almighty and merciful God, source of all life, health, and healing, look with compassion on our world, brought low by disease. Protect us in the midst of the grave challenges that assail us, and in your fatherly providence, grant recovery to the stricken, strength to those who care for them, and success to those working to eradicate this scourge, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Those who wish, you're now invited to come forward for the veneration of the cross with simply a bow or a pause or a genuflection.
Thank you.
Let us pray with confidence now in the words that our Savior gave us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil, and graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all anxiety, as we wait in joyful hope for the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ.
The kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Behold the Lamb of God, behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb.
Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you. who are not receiving communion sacramentally, may we suggest this spiritual communion. My Jesus, I believe you are really present in the Blessed Sacrament. I love you more than anything in the world, and I hunger to receive you. But since I cannot now receive communion, feed my soul at least spiritually. I unite myself to you now, as I do when I actually receive you. Never drift away from you. Amen.
At this hour, O God Most High, while silence reigns and the sun hides its face, a world prostrate beneath its sins lifts its eyes to the cross, rejoicing that the tree of knowledge, which brought the human race to its knees, has become the tree of life, lifting us up to redemption. Let the glorious cross forever stand as the sign of our worth in your eyes. As we behold innocence itself crucified in place of the guilty and life put to death for sinners, may we take heart, remembering the prayer of the dying thief whose faith was rewarded. Let us pray. Almighty ever-living God, who have restored us to life by the blessed death and resurrection of your Christ, preserve in us the work of your mercy, that partaking of this mystery, we may have a life unceasingly devoted to you, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
Yes,
we bow our heads now and pray for God's blessing. May abundant blessing, O Lord, we pray, descend upon your people who have honored the death of your Son in the hope of their resurrection. May pardon come, comfort be given, holy faith increase, and everlasting redemption be made secure. Through Christ our Lord.